Hey.
This is a big project.
Oh. This is over about a year's worth of work to get it to this point. Well, the last thing I want to do is sit here and work with this thing after all the hours.
Well, you have to. It's part of the...
Well, this thing has been temperamental since the day it got it. I mean,
is it 5A's EP4s or similar to them?
Originally it was. These are now, there's two 4860, there's a 4861 tube, and there's one, this is the original tube. The original green tube was burned out. It blew a hole in the top of it. They were talking about trying to pop three of them in there, which means you would have had a...
So they have a compelling reason to make the change.
You think the yoke is the...
Well, I'm going to swap the yokes on them to see what happens. It's the first thing I can isolate, easiest thing, and then I can work from there. Yeah, when I yell.
I'm getting used to it. It's still good.
That's the one we think might be bad.
Oh, there's no marks? There's
no
way to look
nothing.
At
it.
Want the other two?
No, I just got to change the tape on this one. And the short distance is a problem because I have to have the tubes so close.
How many wires are on that?
Six.
Six, so obviously.
That's probably a center tapped coil.
For the horizontal.
Right, and for the vertical.
Yeah, they're stock coils. They're just, so it's, just that they're encased.
Yeah, it doesn't feel like it's broken. We may have just been going to ground.
It was either ground or has nothing to do with the problem.
Right.
Yeah. We'll find out in a minute.
Well, we did have some horizontal sweep, didn't we?
Yeah.
And if we were grounding out to the frame, that could have just been changing the entire load on the coil, changing the inductance, untuning the circuit.
If the center tap goes somewhere and that center tap was grounded, it could have just cut down the amount of sweep.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Better than thinking he's got to start troubleshooting the horizontal sweep circuit for the center.
Mm-hmm. That's probably not going to happen.
What? That's Steve's problem now.
That's right.
Key goes what? Tops?
Yeah, it depends on which way this down. Alright, we'll put the focus control back. Focus voltage back on. Problem is that it depends on the length of the throw. This tilted.
Yeah. So, oh, I see. So we got a lot of space there now, but
now,
you might not.
We may not when we do the alignment on it. Definitely not quite hot enough. Okay, got it. Should be in six. That's it, yeah. The broken one, yeah. That's what I think I had to chip that one out to get it taken there.
How's it look?
The red one sweep them?
Yes.
The high voltage won't come up. It's on now. So we've got a full ratio on the red one. Problem is trying to see. This one's here, but they're open. And I think there's
9 ohms.
Yeah, that's probably
across
about right.
The
yep. Sounds good because it's across the resistor.
About half an ohm. 2 ohms
across
the
pipe. It's a B plus. Black. Boosted B. That goes to the flyback.
Yeah.
I understand, but why would green come there and the other two not?
Now, where does F go to?
F goes to C.
Okay, now wait a minute. We know that C is the right one for the blue yoke. Let me go to these other pins.
Well, we got to go to another yoke.
No. Let's go to from here. This has got to have the blue going down there somewhere.
Check red.
Here. No, it's going up,
you're going up there.
Why don't you check red?
Right.
Can you do that?
Yeah, we can do it.
Or green, whichever one's easier.
Green is easier, it's up there.
Okay.
1/10 of an ohm.
D goes to C.
D goes to C on my side. Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Which is A, B, C is this one.
Have 0 ohms?
No continuity there. So I guess when I pulled it out, when I disconnected it, I pulled it out and it tugged the wire right out of it.
Yeah.
I they're dependent on the clamp on the top.
Might have to take it apart, slide it by hand.
Bad, it's out of focus yet.
You know what? Don't go nuts. You're showing something that doesn't exist anywhere else.
And supposedly there's a way you can do it, but I could never get it to work. You're supposed to be able to sight through the thing and see two images.
I know that. You like
and I could never see the second image.
We need to find a telescope engineer.
Yeah. Well, that's where I got the instructions from.
Can't get any better with it because of the lens and the
You don't happen to have a BNC the RCA copter, do you? I don't know if I have any in the hotel room or not.
The picture tube burned out on it. He couldn't find a replacement. We bought it in the 80s from government surplus out of Sandia Labs. The story goes that it was originally constructed by Dalto in New Jersey for the Lawrence Livermore Labs in California. They made 19 of the units. This is serial number 5. How many of them actually still exist? Probably maybe another one somewhere. So this is a good indication of sets that are very rare and virtually worthless. I've had it at my place for the last year and a half working on it. Probably have about 1,000 hours to get it to this point of working. When I got it, most of the cables had rotted and broken. Most of the electronics were in good shape. Electrolytics all had to be replaced. The biggest problem with it is that the optics, the mechanical optics are out of the line. That's why we'll never get it working right. The fellow that I bought it from was going to junk it. I talked to him on a Friday. He had already stripped all the parts out of it. It was going on the trash heap that Monday when I told him, no, I'll take it. So he put everything back and shipped everything to me. About a month later, I got everything. And then started the problem of trying to figure out how to get the optics back together again. And in the manual, the first thing it tells you to do is never take the lenses out. And I've tried all different ways of aligning the Schmidt setup. By eye on the screen, which doesn't work well. Another method, they tell me to look in the center of the screen, and you'll see two holes. Lens hole and an imaginary hole. Well, I could never see the imaginary hole. It just never showed up in my face. So we got to the point where this was about as good as it's going to get. The unit, again, as you can see, it has 3 Schmidt systems, 3 barrels without barrels on, 3 CRTs. Originally, it used the 5AZP4 variation with the 3 different colors. This one's using the 1970s. 48, 61, 62, and 63 from the 1970s projection set. Runs 40,000 volts on the anodes, so it does generate x-rays. Normally there are lead
which
covers.
We're looking up right now.
Yeah. So far, after a year of working on it, I haven't noticed any glowing, so I'm okay. Uses a stock 12-channel tuner. The D-mod circuit appears to come out straight out of a RCA, probably a CTC 15 chassis or something like that that was added to it. Convergence is all custom-made convergence circuitry in it. It generates probably 25 different waveforms to take care of parabolic correction, tilt, you name it, it's here. There's like 40 controls on this electronics alone. Each CRT has, I think, 10,
10 adjustments for each CRT. Focus, tilt, azimuth, elevation, left and right movement. Totally a massive amount of controls to work with it. Originally, the design of the set was such that you could acquire three different sets of lenses. This one has the short lens set, which works from 10 to 15 feet and projects a 8 to 10 foot picture. The largest lens allowed you to go up to a 24 foot wide picture at 45 feet throw on it. Now, probably this would never do that because the mirrors are, even though they look good, they're not where they're supposed to be. They still have a slight haze to the mirrors on them. Power supply is a RF type supply. Use a voltage tripler. Probably generates 20, 25 watts as they use a pair of 6146s as the output tubes for it. Pretty much everything has its own focus control, its own adjustment for everything on it that you see. There's an adjustment for just about every single individual tube in the set. The setup for the high voltage is kind of weird. It took me, finally I looked at the book on how to do it, of course, because who looks at the book? what they do, they tell you to do with the high voltage is you set up the initial high voltage output at 13,000 volts. Then you adjust the filament voltage for each of the 3A3s to get your 40,000 volts out. Each filament is a small tank circuit that couples off the oscillator through the chassis itself, and you just sort of tweak it, and then very technical, match the brightness of the filaments. That's how you adjust the voltage. Virtually nothing. No, they need the voltage on them. The thing has a tendency of throwing lightning bolts every now and then. They don't hurt too bad. Yeah. Nailed a few times off. The CRTs, the biggest problem I have with it is the CRTs have no cover, no aquadog on the outside. So they hold voltage for weeks. And I found that out the hard way. Turned it on, come back a week later, go grab one of them, and just get pow, one of those things. And I've learned, I respect it a little bit, but it's not that bad anymore.
Did you say there was lug shield?
Yeah, there's the side door panels are all leg covered inside. Now, I don't know if that was stock or something that they did after it was sold. I can't really tell you that. As you can see, color bars look great, but that's because you don't have to be really good conversions to get color bars. As you can see,
real time.
A little bit out of whack at the top of the picture.
Looks better than a
CTC5. 1919. Let me just see if I can get that top center in.
What's the mean time between failures on this unit?
Oh, 20 minutes.
He was expecting our answer.
When they were new, it probably didn't.
I was going to suggest you.
When it was new, it was probably a half an hour. As you can see, we didn't have a 10-foot screen to work on, so which is actually good because you don't get to see all the shit.
The edge of
it. Torture device, the high voltage supply. Probably with
it. Hey, where's the sound?
As I said, this one here is an RF supply.
Yeah, there's that enough of it. Yeah.
Yeah, we got a little bit too much.
It's going to be like getting hit with a stun gun.